Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Are y'all ready to worship the Lord tonight?
Yes.
Good. All right. If y'all could please rise, we'll start with some worship.
My debt is paid
Lord, there is joy in the house of the Lord, Lord. We ask that you will be with us tonight, that you may speak through us, Lord, that you will just be with us tonight, Lord, that you may move in us and through us. And we just give you this time, and we love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We should have just done a little circle. Yeah. No, I'm not going to do that. No. I was listening to a video, and I think it was Melissa Dougherty, and she was talking about, yes, I do listen to, you know, women talk about Bible stuff, because, you know, God gives them, they're intelligent and wise, too. So, and she talked about something that she had read about cultic control, and they used was it anagram bite, which was how cults control you from behavior modification. Oh my gosh, I wrote it down because I knew that this moment would come. And then, because that's one of the things we're talking about, behavior control, information control, thought control, and emotional control. That's one of the ways that Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons get you. They control your behavior, you know, like with Jehovah's Witnesses. They become very proud of the fact that they don't celebrate Easter or Christmas or birthdays or things like that. They're very proud of the fact that, you know, at least they call it a fact, that they realize that Jesus is actually Michael the Archangel, et cetera, et cetera. Right? Yes, Jehovah's Witnesses believe that, absolutely. Their information control, Jehovah's Witnesses are actually given search engines that are controlled by the Jehovah's Witnesses churches and told never to use Google, don't use any of those things, because they're all out to attack the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Whereas I will tell you, I'll give you guys like pagan atheist websites and say, go check them out and read them and, you know, get a good laugh, right? Because it's like, Jesus stands the test of time. He's been standing up. He doesn't need me to fake people out. Thought control, that's one of the ways that they get them, because, you know, they literally have them where they have to think a certain way. They teach them to think a certain way about the scriptures. And I think there's, you know, that's the thing is it's all kind of like there's a little truth to it. But then, you know, it's like I tell people, you know, if you saw this beautiful submarine sandwich and I told you, you know, oh, there's, you know, just a little piece over here got some poop on it. And I'd say, you want the sandwich now? You'd be like, nah, I'm good. I said, well, I'll just chop this end off. And you go, nah, I'm good. Right? I don't want it. But, you know, and they just whoop, whoop. Oh. other class, and there we go. Worky, worky. It's like magic. But there you go. I'll just flip this back there. So in that emotional control and everything that's done, that's one of the reasons that I, you know, it's like, I know sometimes people wish I wouldn't do it, but that's one of the things. Sometimes I just got to say, you know what? You're free in Christ. And you're free in Christ to run into a brick wall sometimes, you know, because you've got to make those decisions and you've got to do those things. All I can do is warn you. All I can do is say the bridge is out. That's all we can do for each other. But I cannot control you, nor will I try to. I'm not the Holy Spirit. But though God uses us to convict people in the Holy Spirit, I really do believe that. But I am not the Holy Spirit himself, so I'm not going to try and control you or do any of those things. I'll just laugh at you as I watch you run into things. It's all good. I love you guys. Turn to... It really does. It really does. You know, they learned it from somebody. You know, Mormons do the same things, right? You have to wear the garment underneath. You have to get married in the temple. You have to tithe so much. For the longest time, they couldn't drink caffeinated drinks. And now they kind of fudge on that a little bit. You know, no smoking, right? You know, which I would encourage you not to smoke either, but I'm not going to tell you you're going to hell because of it, you know, or kick you out of the church. And, you know, the banishment they do with both of those is literally like, we went to the Jehovah's Witness church. We were actually going to look at buying one here in town, and we went to go look at it. And we were like, oh, it's the nursing mother's room. And, you know, like we got in there, and they said, no, it's not the nursing mother's room. And it's like, what is this? Well, basically, if you're being punished by the church, you have to sit in that room because you're not allowed to be amongst the people until you've done proper penance. And if you're bad enough, like if, you know, if you reject the Jehovah's Witness thing, they will literally tell family that you can't hang out with them, you can't be around them, you can't, you know, they will try and, you know, just brutalize you emotionally to get you back into the Jehovah's Witness faith. It's crazy. So anyway, but, you know, I mean, we could punish some of you by putting you back there just to take care of babies, but yeah. So anyway, all right, I'll stop talking now. Let's go on. I don't have any announcements because it's summer, and as you can see, everybody's gone. We do have some people that are sick, so what I'll do is as I open in prayer, we'll also pray for Louise. She did have a seizure today, so and I think she forgot her phone at the dentist, so she might not even be watching this. Louise, if you somehow got your phone, then bless you. And if not, maybe you can watch it tomorrow. And you'll still say here that we're blessing you here. And Miss Cindy sounds like she's got a migraine going on. So, yes, ma'am. Oh, man. And that's crazy. Thyroid issues are just nuts. That's okay. Yeah, it's, never mind. I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to do it. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, so, I mean, yeah, thyroid will mess with you. And like I tell people, and sickness, illness can really make you, can really mess with you. And emotionally, mentally, you know, so it's like, forgive me, I have to remold this to my head now. So if I keep playing with it, please forgive me. Turn to Ezra chapter 3, and as you do, let's lift everybody up in prayer. Father, we just, we thank you for Louise, Lord. We pray for the seizures that she keeps happening. And Lord, we pray that you would heal her right now, Father, that you would touch her in a way that would just take these things away. Lord, and if you choose not to, Lord, we pray that you would use medicine, that you would guide the doctor's hands, that Father, they would take her off of so many of these pills and everything else that she's on, Lord, and help get her right and get her balanced. We pray for a doctor that would care for her, truly care for her, and not just seek to keep her medicated. Lord, also want to pray for Miss Cindy. I pray that You balance out her magnesium and salt and everything else that's necessary, Lord. We pray that it's not a sickness or illness, that it's not the new COVID that's going around, Lord. We pray that it would just be a migraine, perhaps just brought on by dehydration. We're all sweating so much, Lord, in this particular weather, except for some of us, like Paula. She's not sweating, but... Lord, but the rest of us, Father, it's just, it wears you out, and that we need to replace those things in us, and we just pray that you would keep her whole and healthy, and that she's been fighting with so much recently that it's just, it wears on you. And, you know, just speaking of that, we just lift up Miss Lisa to you, Lord, just her thyroid issues and the things that are going on there. It can change our personalities and really affect us, Lord, and darken our mood and bring us just to a really bad place. So, Lord, I pray for a supernatural peace for her, a supernatural joy, Lord, and just pray that she would not let this illness control her, but that, Lord, she would choose joy. And even in the midst of it, and that's why Paul said, rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. Even in the midst of trials and tribulations and struggle and pain, Lord, this is just a temporary place. We're just pilgrims, and we're actually moving towards eternity with you. And just the knowledge of that, Lord, is a reminder that this is, I'm going to get over this. We're going to get through this, and you're going to get us there in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, welcome to Calvary Chapel, sir. Is his first time? Is his first time coming in tonight? So, Ezra chapter 3, we finished with verse 70 last time. The priests, Levites, some of the people, the singers, the gatekeepers, and the Nethinim dwelt in their cities, and all Israel in their cities. Chapter 3, verse 1 begins, when the seventh month had come and the children of Israel were in the cities, the people gathered together as one man to Jerusalem. So, and the reason for that, why? We're going to see here in just a minute, it's because the Feast of Tabernacles has come. And that was one of the celebrations where they were supposed to go to Jerusalem and partake of that. There was one thing missing, though, and that's what one of the things we're going to see here. So they gathered as one man to Jerusalem. Then Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, and his brethren the priest, and Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and his brethren arose and built the altar of God in Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it is written in the law of Moses, the man of God. Notice, they couldn't build the altar anywhere they wanted. They had to build it where God had set. And like he said, you know, we've got to build it to the way that Moses had set, to the way it had been set for the tabernacle. So that's what they did. So they built this altar to God in Israel so that they can do their sacrifices, so the priests can be, can be anointed, can do the job that they're called to do. But look at the reason why they do it, though fear, right? So even in the midst of this fear, though fear had come among them because of the people of these countries, they set the altar on its base. They offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord, both the morning and the evening burnt offerings. They also kept the Feast of Tabernacles, that is, as it is written, and offered the daily burnt offerings in the number required by ordinance for each day. And then afterwards they offered the regular burnt offering and those for the new moons and for all the appointed feasts of the Lord that were consecrated. And, you know, so, you know, we sometimes think in a linear fashion, but you got to remember as he's going through this, sometimes he's talking about, you know, it's not linear, and he's going to jump back and forth, and, you know, he's going to begin here and then go there. But here, this is the seventh month, so he's given us a timetable and saying all the way up to the second month of the second year in verse 8, right? So we're seeing a number of months go by during this, right? Because it's new moons, it's the daily burnt offerings, it's the appointed feasts that were consecrated, and those of everyone who willingly offered a freewill offering to the Lord. From the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, though the foundation of the temple had not been laid. They also gave money to the masons and the carpenters and food, drink, and oil to the people of Sidon and Tyre to bring cedar logs from Lebanon to the sea to Joppa according to the permission which they had from Cyrus the king. So the first thing you see here is they set up the altar. Why? Okay. Why? Because for them to be able to do the appropriate sacrifices and to do the things, they needed an altar. Right? Because that is what had been set by for the Lord. So for all this time, they couldn't partake of Passover. They couldn't really partake of the Feast of Tabernacles. They couldn't do any of these things because they couldn't properly make a sacrifice, right? And that's one of the things when you see in your life, right, what am I missing? What's going on here? Is there a step that I'm missing here? Because God's given them a progression of how they are to worship him. And you know, it comes from sacrifice, from the shedding of innocent blood to cover and atone for the sins of the people. Over and over and over again, God gives that picture of Christ to them, and he does the same for us. What's one of the things that Paul says that we're to do? What altar are we to get on? Right? Where is that at? Well, it is the mercy seat. But what scripture am I talking about where he says that you get on the altar? Michael, you're not allowed to answer. No, neither are you, Andrew. No, Michael cannot answer for you. Romans. Make yourselves a living sacrifice. You're not allowed. You are banned. You are banished from it. You are not allowed. It is your first time. No justices. You know, so it's like Romans 12, 1 and 2, you know, he tells us to get up on the altar, to make ourselves a living sacrifice. You know, the whole idea of it, you know, is God is doing this and he's doing all these offerings and he's having these feasts. And we know that the greatest of our sacrifices is in Jesus Christ. But at the same time, right, All the offerings and the feasts and everything that they do, the main thing is each one of those feasts, each one of those places, you know, each of them has a Sabbath within it. Did you know that? That every feast begins, you know, the beginning of every feast and usually the end of every feast comes, there's a Sabbath. Huh? Sabbath. You know, bless you. So, Shavuot. But Shabbat, you know, Shabbat. But here's the thing. The reason it comes with the Sabbath is because that is another day of rest and is a holy day that is set apart for the Lord, right? And Jesus tells us, though, that, you know, man was not made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for man. You know, he turned the idea around of what, you know, people even now today make it out to be. I know people that say you have to do it on a Saturday and you have to do all these things. And it's like, do you not understand that Jesus is our Sabbath? I am in the Sabbath 100% of my day, right? I wake up, it's Shabbat, right? I wake up and, you know, I'm having my Sabbath because Jesus is my rest and he's my all. He's also the one that went on the altar for me. And that's that thing we see with the altar here. We're talking about that too much. Let's move on. So, but notice too, they pay everybody. They do everything they're supposed to do. They gave money to the masons, the carpenters, food and drink and oil to the people of Sidon and Tyre. They're paying their way. They're not just trying to hoard it or get free stuff, you know. And sometimes I do that. I do that. When I call certain companies, I'll ask them if they have nonprofit licenses or stuff like that for software and things. But I will never just try and get something free, especially from people in our local economy, because I want to make sure that they get paid. Because they're in a business, right? And I want to make sure they get, you know, they need that. You know, so I just, yeah, just kind of making that point that, you know, they paid for what they were using and what they were doing, and they paid people for their labor. Now, you know, and, I mean, the Bible literally says, you know, don't muzzle an ox, right? As he's, you know, huh? as he's treading the grain, right? So you don't muzzle him so he can eat and partake of what he's doing, and that's what they're doing for the people. Now in the second month, verse 8 of chapter 3, of the second year coming to the house of God at Jerusalem. So notice, even though there's no foundations for the temple, they're still calling it the house of God, right? They're still saying this is where God, you know, this is to them, this is where God's presence is on earth. And I think that's one of the things, too, we see with people who go visit Israel and go to Jerusalem. They come back changed, right? I've had friends that went on trips to Israel, and they come back all freaked out, you know, and they're all wearing their little prayer shawls, and they put their yarmulkes on, and I'm like, you're not Jewish, bro. And they're like, but you don't understand. It was amazing. And they're just, it's a life-changing experience when you go to a place. And you got to think, man, it's like, you know, like the most historical place. And what's the most historical place any of you have ever been to? Like super cool place. What'd you say? The Cactus Hotel. Man, you have a really sad life. Yeah, Lisa. The Colosseum in Rome. Did you actually get to touch the walls and go sit on the... Oh, my gosh. The catacombs. Oh, my gosh. That's what, Liz?
Your house. Red Square in Moscow.
Red Square in Moscow, right? The Incan Pyramids. How awesome is that? Now, yeah, because I can remember going to some of the Aztec ruins, not Mayan ruins, right? That's where we went. We went to the Mayan ruins, and you know, it had the things where when you clapped, it sounded like birds chirping, and you know, I mean, and that stuff has been, you know, it's been abandoned for centuries, right? Still works, you know, and it's just, you know, you go to these places and you're just amazed at the history and things that you see there. So imagine when you go to some place like Israel, you know, and you're like, Jesus walked here, right? I mean, God, who came in the flesh, literally died on one of these hills, you know? I mean, that's crazy. You know, and that's why it changes you mentally, and you know, because you're, you know, we're human beings, and we're so limited right now of our view of space and time and all these things. So when these things happen, when they say, you know, this is the place of the house of God, these are people who literally were told, you know, and this, like, I want to say it's like 72 years to the day when they finally finish everything, according to some calculations. We'll look at that here in a minute. But the fact is they were told, you're going to be 70 years in Babylon. And then what happens 70 years later? They're back, right? You know? I mean, think about that. You're like, okay, we're back at the house of God because God said so. So, you know, it says that the rest of their brethren, the priests, the Levites, and all those who have come out of their captivity to Jerusalem begin work and appointed the Levites from 20 years old and above to oversee the work of the house of the Lord. Because to actually be a priest in the house of the Lord, you had to be over 20 years of age. Because that was when you were, you know, considered to be able to work it. Right now, it doesn't mean that was the age of accountability. I've heard some people try to use this as an age of accountability thing. And it's like, that's kind of silly. Why would you go there? You know, the age of accountability is when you, do you know what you did wrong? And they go, yeah. All right. You know, that's the age of, that's when they're accountable, right? When they know what they did wrong, when they know they did wrong, when they know they sinned. You know, so it said, but this is just what God had set, okay? It's mentioned in First Chronicles too that this is where, you know, this is the age that they begin being priests. And Jeshua with his sons and brothers, Kadmiel with his sons and the sons of Judah, verse 9 is where we're at, arose as one to oversee those working on the house of God. So it's like, you know, it doesn't say they got a plan together and did this, but, you know, that's kind of the implication here is they're overseeing the work of the house of God, and they all have the same mind and the same plan and the same vision. They are all bound and determined to make this happen, right? This is not, you know, and this is the thing, man. This is for God. You know, most, you know, some of these people are getting paid, but these priests and all that, they're not. They're having to work and scrape and survive and do all these things, and then they're putting together the house of God at the same time. You know, I mean, we get up and I go to my fridge and go, and I get some water, and then I pour it in the coffee machine, and I do all those things. You know, what if you had to go out and you wake up and you're like, oh, man, and I got to go run the grinder and I got to do the pestle and I got to kill the chicken and I got to get the eggs and wash the stink off of them. And, you know, it's like we're so spoiled by our you know, our, huh?
I said convenience.
Convenience, yeah. You know, our culture and society has forgotten what it's like to have to, you know, scrape and scrounge to survive. It's like you go to Mexico on a mission trip and you go to, you know, some of the Mayan villages where, you know, and some of the places in Mexico, just in, you know, I mean, there's places like that in, you know, huh? Oh, Philadelphia, yeah, where people are cooking on a dirt floor. In the middle, you know, they've only got one room. Everybody sleeps in it. When they wake up, they chase everybody out of the room. They clean it up, and it becomes the kitchen. And then when they're done cooking, they call everybody back in, and then that's, you know, that's now the dining room table. You know, it's everything, you know, and it's all done on a dirt floor. And here, that's how these people are living. We got to understand that when we look at this. These people aren't doing a 9-to-5 job. You know, this is a hard, hard life that they're doing. Yeah, and it says their sons and brethren, the Levites. And then verse 10, when the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests stood in their apparel with the trumpets, and the Levites, the sons of Asaph, with cymbals to praise the Lord according to the ordinance of David, king of Israel. Okay, so it's like, I mean, they have done these things, and it's according to the ordinance of David, and it's something that had been set. You know, and David has said, this is how you'll do it, and this is the worship that you do. You know, so they're singing psalms, they're singing praises, you know, and it's just becoming this amazing thing. And they sing responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever toward Israel. And why would they say that? Because God had said that. You know, it's an act of, you know, it's not just an act of faith that they're doing it, but they're seeing it happen in their lives. Just like sometimes I know you guys see it in your life. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes everything just seems like a struggle, you know, but sometimes you see it. You see those glimpses, you see those things, and you're just like, okay, God's working in my life, right? And you need to see that. And when you see it, you need to realize, you know, your God has said that, you know, he would never leave you, never abandon you. He never forsake you. So you got to, you know, do you trust him? Do you believe that? Even when you don't see him, even when you don't feel him, right? Do you know he's there? And these guys, you know, here it is, 70 years later, God is doing exactly what he said he would do. So they are like, they're happy, and all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and the Levites, heads of the fathers' houses, old men who had seen the first temple, they wept with a loud voice. So, you know, it's 70 years, so most of these guys were probably like anywhere from 10 to 15 years of age or younger when they saw the temple in its glory, you know, Solomon's temple. And now they're probably looking at something that doesn't quite look like Solomon's temple. You know what I'm saying? You know? But yet, it's a restoration. And it's an act of God. And it's a thing that he does. Right? I mean, I've been to million-dollar facilities. I've been to churches where, you know, what they would spend on their front foyer is worth more than everything in this building and everything I own at home. Right? You know? But man, when I walk in here, it's like, I'm like, okay, God, this is God's place, right? This is God's people's place. This is where God's people come and we fellowship together. And it's like, and you know it's there. And, you know, and it's like, and because that's what I see. I don't see just a raggedy old place. And when these old people, they're looking at it and they're seeing something restored that had been taken away, where, you know, their entire race had been made slaves. And now, you know, it says that some of them were crying so loud with the foundation of this temple was laid before their eyes, yet many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not discern the noise of the shout of joy from the noise of the weeping of the people. For the people shouted with a loud shout, and the sound was heard afar off. Because you got to remember, there, you know, the city of Jerusalem is on a hill, right? I mean, it's literally called the city on a hill. So, you know, and you know, the sound travels. And here it says they shouted so loud that their adversaries heard them. And most of their adversaries were probably, you know, just on the Mount of Olives across from it. But still, you know, still. And look what it says in chapter 4, verse 1. Now, the adversaries, okay, the adversaries, the word in the Hebrew literally means enemies, all right? So notice, the text tells you these are the bad guys, okay? So you've got the who, all right? The who, the adversaries, the enemies of Judah and Benjamin heard, you know, and why does it say and Benjamin? Huh? Because Benjamin was the coolest kid on the block. The lost tribe? No. No. Where was Israel? Where was Jerusalem located? In Benjamin. Right. So that's why it says, you know, it's telling you, you know, it's regarding that the enemies of Judah, because Judah is the major tribe where it is. Benjamin is the one that is, you know, that Jerusalem is actually on. So here, you know, it's like, you know, and Benjamin technically, I think, is like in the smack dab in the middle of Judah, right? So, but they're considered one tribe. And then here, you know, it says that they're the enemies of Judah and Benjamin. And they heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel. So they came to Zerubbabel and the heads of the fathers' houses and said to them, let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do. All right. So here are the people who would eventually become the Samaritans, who were considered the half-breeds, the, you know, the lowlifes, the nobodies. 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 33, told us about the attitude of the Samaritans. They feared the Lord, yet served their own gods according to the rituals of the nations from among whom they were carried away. So they came to Israel. They feared the God of Israel. They wanted to worship him. They just didn't want to give up their old gods, right? So, you know, so they come to Zerubbabel, the heads of the fathers' houses, but they're, you know, again, the text has already told us, they don't mean this, right? They don't mean this. They are the enemies of Judah. They are the enemies of the work of God, right? So don't think that, you know, Israel's dissing them or anything like that, but at the same time, Israel's being obedient to the word of God. He says, let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do, and we have sacrificed to him since the days of Esharon, king of Assyria, who brought us here. So they're like, yeah, the Assyrians brought us here, and we've been doing those things, and we had talked about that. So, you know, but it's like, you know, Israel here understands and knows greatly because they're looking for the word, they're gathering it up, they're seeking to be obedient, and they know they can't include, you can't include unbelievers or idolaters in the work of God, because you know, inclusion of somebody that hasn't yielded or submitted to God, it can give them a false sense of security. It can make them think, well, maybe God's okay with me because, you know, I'm running the soundboard or I'm doing the lyrics, right? So God's cool with me now, right? He didn't zap me, he didn't fry me when I was up here. I wasn't talking about you guys. I'm not saying you guys ain't saved. I'm just saying, right? Must be Michael, yeah. Or you're playing the cajon, right? But you know, you get what I'm saying, right? The idea is that, you know, that it's a false sense of security for us as believers in Jesus Christ. That's why, you know, you got to test people. You got to talk to who they are. You got to test every spirit. But for them, it was literally a command that only Israelites could work on this. Only those craftsmen could work on it. They couldn't use certain types of tools. They can only do certain things, right? Because that was what God had said. So, you know, so Zerubbabel and the rest of the heads of the fathers of the house of Israel said to them, verse 3, chapter 4, to build, you know, you may do nothing with us to build a house for our God, but we alone will build the house, you know, build to the Lord God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us. So what do they do? First, they say we're appealing to God as to why we're building and what we're building. The second appeal is to the authority of the worldly, you know, system that is going on there. You know, the people who literally, you know, kept Israel as slaves and freed them to come do this. So what happens? Verse 4, the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah, and they troubled them in building, and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purposes all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So, you know, and so this goes on for like a year, okay? So this is just attacking and attacking and hitting and hitting, you know, and it's like, so it's... And it says they hired counselors against them. The counselors, you know, you and I read it, and it's like, oh, so they were trying to help them, right? You know, they were giving them counselors. So they, you know, it's like, no, it's not the same thing. These counselors are those that plotted, planned, and schemed. It means they come up, they came up, you know, they hired people to purposefully and maliciously come against the people of Israel and what they were doing. We see the same thing in our politics today. We see people pretending to be one group or another that come in, you know, and we call it false flags nowadays, right? You'll have people, you know, they would have, you know, it's like, and they speak against it, they come against it, they're robbing them, they're stealing from them, they're lying to them, you know, it's just all those things are under that same umbrella. Verse 6, in the reign of King you know, just to let you know, verse like 6 through, I don't know, like all the way through like verse 23 or 24. So like the whole rest of this chapter. And I'm not going to, probably not going to explain it well because it's kind of complicated. And I'm not sure, having looked at what I have looked at, because it says in the reign of King Ahasuerus, in the beginning of his reign, they wrote an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. So Ahasuerus is someone that comes like many years later and isn't king at this time. Now, and I've heard some scholars say, well, this was like a title and not an actual name of a king. Because they, you know, they found where other kings, you know, how you've always, you know, King Richard the First, Second, Third, you know, Henry the Eighth, I am, right? So it's like, you know, it's like it's a title as much as it is a name, which is a distinct possibility, and it could have been somebody that wasn't, you know, that wasn't Assyrian even, right? Because I mean, Zerubbabel is a Jew who's working on the temple, and his name is Son of Babylon. That's his name, right? So, you know, so, it, you know, anyway, there's all kinds of arguments. There's all kinds of ins and outs on it. Some people say that what you're about to read is a combination of Ezra and other authors who actually come in at a later time and talk about just how the people of the land, i.e. the Samaritans, consistently and constantly come against Israel. So I'm just going to read it to you, and you can read along with me, or, you know, take your evening nap, because here we go. In the reign of Ahasuerus, in the beginning of his reign, they wrote an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. In the days of Artaxerxes also, Bishlam, Mithridath, Tabel, and the rest of their companions wrote to Artaxerxes, king of Persia, and the letter was written in Aramaic script and translated into the Aramaic language. Aramaic is technically a dead language as of like 700, I think, AD, when it became Arabic, right? So Aramaic is no longer an active language, but it's the root and base for Arabic, okay? Just, you know, kind of putting that out there. So... and I think Aramaic became like the main language after they went. They were taken captive into Babylon, and you know, it kind of replaced a lot of Hebrew. You know, so anything you read after this point in the text that they have found was written in Aramaic. Even in the copyists, and when they did it, they copied it in Aramaic. So, says the letter was written in Aramaic script and translated into the Aramaic language. Rehum, the commander of Shimshai, just such cool names, right? Yeah, you want to call your cat that. Shimshai! Stop it! Don't choke that hairball up right there. So, the commander in Shimshai, the scribe, wrote a letter against Jerusalem to King Artaxerxes in this fashion. From Rehum the commander, Shimshai the scribe, the rest of their companions, representatives of the Dinites. I'm going to ruin some of these. I'm just telling you. Afarsakhites, right? The Tarpalites, the people of Persia, the Erech, the Babylon, and Shushan, the Devaites, the Elamites, and the rest of the nations whom the great and noble O-snapper, right? Osnapper. You can roll it around. It probably sounds really cool if you it a little bit or something like that, but this is Texas, and we say O-snapper, right? They took captive and settled in the cities of Samaria and the remainder beyond the river and so forth. So it's almost like, even as he's writing this, whoever's writing it in Aramaic, so literally it's, and you go, and so on, so it's like, you know the story, is basically what the script is saying. And they would write that way to each other because they would begin with a pretext of this is the history of this, and then you know how the rest went, right? Because it's like they don't, paper is expensive, the scribe is expensive, everything costs money, right? And any of you ever get a text or an email that's 5 miles long? How many of you read the first few sentences and go, I'm going to guess the rest of this, right? That's kind of what he's doing here. He's like, kings don't like to sit there and listen to 15 minutes of stuff. It's like, get to the point. And this is a copy of the letter they sent him, verse 11. To King Artaxerxes from your servants, the men of the region beyond the river and so forth. Let it be known. Let it be known to the king that the Jews who came up from you have come to us at Jerusalem. They are building the rebellious and evil city. And technically, Jerusalem, Israel has always been rebellious against those that would try to take it over, right? This rebellious and evil city, that's subjective, right? And are finishing its walls and repairing the foundations. So it's like, here, the rebellious and evil city, they're rebuilding it. Just letting you know, now let it be known to the king that if this city is built and the walls completed, they won't pay tax. They're not going to pay. How do you get a king involved? How do you get a government involved? How do you get the IRS looking at you? Yeah. We can say taxation is theft, but boy, oh boy, try not paying them. See what happens, right? Ruby Ridge. But they will not pay tax, tribute, or custom, and the king's treasury will be diminished. That's how you get everybody's attention. That's how they got it. That's how they got my attention in the Navy. When they took me to my second captain's mast, they knocked me down ranks, and it was like, ooh, my paycheck got smaller real quick. Yeah, I was a bad boy. So, your treasure will be diminished. That gets your attention. They're saying you're not going to get as much money as you normally would. But nobody's paying taxes there already anyway because it's abandoned, right? There's nobody, and it's like, so you're telling me the place that is generating no tax is not going to give me any tax? Come on, son. Really? But no, they're not going to see it that day. Now, because we received support from the palace, it was not proper for us to see the king's dishonor. Therefore, we have sent and informed the king that a search be made in the book of the records of your fathers, because many of these kings would come in and they'd have these vast empires. They couldn't remember everything that happened everywhere, So this new king, Artaxerxes, is taken over from Darius, right? And so it's like, I think it's Darius. Is that who it was before? Asher. Well, that's what they call him now, which is which is Artaxerxes. But who was it that actually gave the order for them to come? Cyrus. So Cyrus was king, and then another person became king, and then another, because that's just the nature of it, right? So they tell the current king, hey, dude, go look at the books. Go look in the books of the records of your fathers. You'll find in the book of the records and know that this city is a rebellious city, harmful to the kings and provinces, that they have incited sedition with the city in former times, which caused the city was destroyed. They ain't lying, right? I mean, you go to Jerusalem, and that's it's like the funniest things. And they'll tell you, you know, you have two Jews, you have three arguments, right? It's just they can't get along with each other, they can't get along with anybody else, and they love to fight and argue, right? They're contrarians, it seems, by nature, but, you know, just very passionate and on fire, you know, and they believe that they're called by God to be in this city, right? So they're not lying. We inform the king that, you know, if it's completed, you know, we inform the king if this city is rebuilt and its walls are completed, the result will be you have no dominion beyond the river, right? They're just going to ignore you. So the king sent an answer to Rehum the commander, to Shimshai the scribe, to the rest of their companions who dwell in, so they didn't name off everybody like they did, and to the remainder, you know, to the remainder beyond the river. So we're just, you know, including everybody. Peace and so forth, right? I think that's just cool, you know? And it's like you and I, we go, you know, yada, yada, yada. That's basically what they're saying. Peace and whatever, whatever, right? And the letter which you sent to us has been clearly read before me. I gave the command, and a search has been made, and it was found this city in former times has revolted against kings and rebellion and sedition and been fostered in it. There has also been many mighty kings over Jerusalem who ruled over the region beyond the river, and tax, tribute, and custom were paid to them. So, you know, he says, well, you know, technically they have been doing those things, and they actually took taxes and tributes from the places amongst the river, right? So he says, now give the command to make these men cease, that the city may not be built until the command is given by me. Take heed now that you do not fail to do this. Why should the damage increase to the herd of the kings? So they had done everything that they could to get in the way of the building, and when that didn't work, you know, it's like, what do your kids do when mom says no? Go to dad, right? Or vice versa. Yeah. I mean, I've seen it. I've seen your children, and I'm not naming anybody. I've seen your children go to you and say, can I get a donut? No. And then what happens? They go to somebody else. My dad said I can have a donut. Right? And so that's what they're doing. They're playing the game, and they're like, you know, hey, your dad said they could do it, but we want you to look at it now and say, what do you think? Right? And so when the copy of King Artaxerxes' letter was read before Rehum, Shimshai the scribe, and their companions, they went up to hasten Jerusalem against the Jews, and by force of arms made them cease. So now it's returned to Hebrew. Okay? Thus the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem, ceased, and it was discontinued until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. But the way that it happens and the things that happen, you know, they're playing the system and they're using it against Israel. But, you know, remember what the Psalms say, you know. What's that that verse you like so much? The Lord moves the kings like the rivers. Talking to you, Mason. You told it to me once. The Lord moves the king's hearts like the rivers. It's a proverb. Yeah. Okay, no, it's either a psalm or a proverb. They say it's proverbs. But the whole idea of it is, you know, if the system, if the enemy uses the system to come against you, God will just move the hearts of the system, right? He'll kill a king, put another king in, he'll move and do things. You know, he is God and he is sovereign. Does he override the will of people sometimes? I think he does, you know? Proverbs 21:1, thank you. Okay, what does it say? Turneth it. You got it. You're looking at King James on your phone. You cheater. Okay. All right, because I was like, turneth. He turnip it? What? A turnip? Right. Yeah. Well, thank thee. All right. So, the prophet Haggai and Zechariah, the son of Iddo, prophets, prophesied to the Jews who were in Jerusalem. So now Haggai, Zechariah, the prophets are coming by this time. And I can't remember who it was. You know, the scriptures have been, you know, and we saw the scriptures earlier have been found and read, and God's just doing all this work in amongst the people. And you know, so the prophets prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was over them. Okay? So preachers moved by God preach to the people who are moved by God. You know, and sometimes that's just what happens, right? And it's like, I mean, you can go, and I, you know, it's happened to me. I've gone to certain, you know, gone to a message or gone to a teaching or just gone to church, right? Go on a Wednesday night, you know, you're barely able to keep your eyes open. You know, they got the AC on full blast, and you're just like, oh, man, I could take a nap right now. But then you hear that one thing, and you're just like, and it clicks in your mind and in your head, and it won't let go, and it becomes a bug up there that just moves on you, right? You know, you can talk to other people, and they'll be like, yeah, it was all right. And you're just like, nah, dude, something clicked in here, and God did something. You know, and that's one of the things that's happening with the people, because Haggai and Zechariah are literally being moved by God to say and do these things. You know, and so they come to, and they come in the name of God of Israel who was over them. So Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, rose up and began to, so they're not waiting for the king to give them a go-ahead. The preachers come in, they tell them, you know, what were we called here for? What are we supposed to be doing? And so Zerubbabel goes, we're supposed to be building, y'all. You know, let's get to building. So that's what they do. They rose up and they began to build the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. And the prophets of God were with them, helping them. You know, they were in the midst of the work, doing the work, and preaching it at the same time. At the same time, Tattenai, the governor of the region beyond the river, and Shethar-Boznai and their companions came to them and spoke to them. And, you know, that's one of the reasons you don't see them, like, writing all the names of everybody that's involved with all these things and all these letters. You know, it'll take, you know, take 15 minutes just to get through everybody's names and waste a whole piece of paper, right? So they came to them and spoke to them thus, you know, who has commanded you to build this temple and finish this wall? So they're like, what are you guys doing? You know, you can't be doing this. Then accordingly, we told them the names of the men who were constructing this building. But the eye of their God was upon the elders of the Jews so that they could not make them cease. So they're trying to do everything. They're threatening them with Darius. They're saying, hey, we're going to go to the boss. And they're just like, okay, all right. And they just keep working. They just keep going. Right? You know, it's like one of those things when people come to you and it's like you really feel like God's gotten you to do something and you just can't not do it. God pushes on your heart and says, man, you need to do this. And people will come to you and say, you can't do this. You're not qualified. And you go, okay. And then you go do it. You know? Or somebody might come up and go, you know, I don't know if you're smart enough for this. And you go, okay. And then you go do it. Why? Because God said, go do it. And here, you know, God is making a way for them. The eye of their God was upon the elders. You know, I mean, we sing it every Sunday, right? You know, his countenance upon you, right? And give thee peace. And so it's like they have a peace about everything that they're doing. They're doing the work of the Lord, you know, and it's just not working. It's just not working for them. Then a written answer was returned concerning, you know, so that, you know, they could not make them cease till a report go to Darius. Then a written answer was returned concerning this matter. This is a copy of the letter that Tattenai sent. The governor of the region beyond the river and Shethar-Boznai and his companions, the Persians, who were in the region beyond the river, to Darius the king. Right? So it's like some of your people were with us too. And they sent a letter to him, which was written thus. To Darius the king. So, you know, and if you're, you know, some of your texts in your Bibles actually separates it out. And so, you know, this is telling you, this is again written in Aramaic. To Darius the king, all peace. Let it be known to the king. And it's also telling you it's a letter within the letter here. Let it be known to the king that we went into the province of Judea to the temple of the great God, which is being built with heavy stones. And timber is being laid in the walls. And this work goes on diligently. And prospers in their hands. So, I mean, these guys are literally, they're not lying. Again, you know, it's funny how the world does that, right? It comes against the work of God. It uses what, you know, it's like, it's not a lie. God is really prospering their hands. They're really getting this work done. And we asked these elders and spoke thus to them. Who commanded you to build this temple and finish these walls? We also asked them their names to inform me that we might write the names of the men who were chief among them. And they returned to us an answer saying, we're the servants of the God of heaven and earth. We are rebuilding the temple that was built many years ago, which a great king of Israel built and completed. But because our fathers provoked, notice, they don't say because, you know, the king, decided, of Babylon decided to punish us. No, because our fathers provoked the God of heaven to wrath, and he gave them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed this temple and carried the people away to Babylon. Our fathers provoked God. This was us, you know. What does the Bible say? What does James tells us? Submit to God, resist the devil, he'll flee from you. Everything we see in the Bible, God gives us in it, you know. I mean, he does give us prescriptions and things that we can do, right? Israel, the first thing they build is the altar so that they can make the sacrifices. What is the first thing God asks you to do? Make your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And don't be conformed to this world, right? I mean, if you put yourself as a living sacrifice to God, you can't be conformed to the world. In it, but not of it, right? However, they say, you know, however, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Babylon, King Cyrus issued a decree to build this house of God, also the gold and silver articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple. They gave us all the stuff back, right? That was in Jerusalem, carried to the temple of Babylon. Those King Cyrus took from the temple of Babylon. They were given to one name, Sheshbazzar, whom he had made governor. Can you imagine being one of these guys going, who said you could do this? And then, boom, they launch off into this history thing, and they're like, oh, my gosh. And there's got to be a guy, like, scribbling this down on a clay tablet somewhere, right? It's just hilarious to me. You know, so it's like, who do you think you are? Well, let me tell you, right? You know, it's kind of like when people kind of, you know, who do you think you are when you're walking in Christ and you're walking in righteousness? And then you go, let me tell you, you know, once upon a time, there was a man named Adam, and again, and you start going off and then launch into the history of what the gospel is and who Jesus, you know, and it's like, and so they say, you know, they take these articles, go carry them to the temple, the site that is Jerusalem, let the house of God be rebuilt in its former site. Then the same Sheshbazzar came and laid the foundation of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem, and from that time even now, it has been under construction, and it is not finished. So, like, you know, it's supposed to be under construction, so it's not finished yet. Now, therefore, it seems, you know, good to the king. So they're like, okay, these guys are still working on it. They didn't give his names. They're not doing these things. Now, therefore, if it seems good to the king, let a search be made in the king's treasure house, which is there in Babylon, whether it is so that a decree was issued by King Cyrus to build this house of God at Jerusalem, and let the king send us his pleasure concerning this matter. So they're like, find the proof. Find the evidence. They're, you know, they're kind of giving the king an out, saying, you know, if you can't find it, then we can stop all this mess, right? We can stop all these things from happening. King Darius issued a decree, chapter 6, verse 1. And a search was made in the archives where the treasures were stored in Babylon. And at Ekmetha, in the palace that is in the province of Media, a scroll was found, and in it a record was written thus: in the first year of King Cyrus, King Cyrus issued a decree concerning the house of God at Jerusalem. So one of the first things King Cyrus does is issue this decree. Let the house be rebuilt, the place where they offered sacrifices. Let the foundations of it be firmly laid, its height 60 cubits, its width 60 cubits, with 3 rows of heavy stones and 1 row of new timber. Let the expenses be paid from the king's treasury. Let also gold and silver of the articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar took from the temple, which is in Jerusalem, and brought to Babylon, be restored, taken back to the temple, which is in Jerusalem, each to its place, and deposit them in the house of God. Now, therefore, Tattenai, governor of the region beyond the river, and Shethar-Bozni, and your companions, the Persians, who are beyond the river, keep yourselves far from there. Shut your pie hole and leave. It's basically what the king just said. Shut it. Get out. Kick rocks. Be gone. Let the work of the house of God. This is from a Babylonian king, right? Let the work of this house of God, again, he believes in all the gods, but yet God is moving the heart of this king to say these things. Let the work of this house of God alone, let the governor of the Jews and the elders of the Jews build this house of God on its site. Let them do what they were commanded to do. Moreover, I issue a decree as to what you shall do for the elders of these Jews. You want to get in somebody's business? Let's get to business. Right? I mean, the verbiage is without, you know, there's no interpretation here, right? Moreover, I issue a decree. So this is a decree. What is a decree? It means you do it. It's a command. Yeah, it's the same, you know, in Aramaic, it's the same word that would be translated commandment. I issue a commandment to you, right? As to what you shall do for the elders of these Jews for the building of this house of the God, let the cost be paid at the king's expense from taxes on the region beyond the river. You know the place where you said that they used to collect taxes and do things for the city? Why don't you take the taxes from there and put it into the city? This is to be given immediately to these men so that they are not hindered. Right? I mean, that's just awesome. So the system that was used by the enemy, you know, to come against the people of God and the work of God, God said, okay, well, let's move these things and have them go around and, you know, and do the work for it. And whatever they need, young bulls, rams, lambs for the burnt offerings of the God of heaven, wheat, salt, wine, oil, according to the request of the priests who are in Jerusalem, let it be given to them day by day without fail, daily, that they may offer sacrifices of sweet aroma to the God of heaven and pray for the life of the king and his sons. So it's like, this is from me, and I want you to think about me when you read this letter and you obey these commands, right? I mean, that's just awesome. And I issue a decree, so another commandment, that whoever alters this edict, let a timber be pulled from his, and they meant this. Let a timber be pulled from his house and erected, and let it be hanged on it, and let his house be made a refuse heap because of this. Now, you read this, I want you to understand, this was a thing that they did. The Assyrians were very popular for this. They called it poling. And they would basically take the sharp end, and they would drop you on the sharp end, and then you would slowly fall down that thing. So when it says they would hang you on it, that's how they would hang you on it. And you were alive until, you know, yeah, it was horrible. Yeah, you were alive until you weren't. That's right. You know? So they literally, you know, so, I mean, that's pretty serious. You'd read that and you'd go, I might not want to do this. I might want to be obedient to the decree. Right? And may the God who causes his name to dwell there destroy any king or people who put their hand to the altar, alter it, or to destroy this house of God which is in Jerusalem. I, Darius, issue a decree. You let it be done diligently. Don't waste my time. Don't waste time. So Tattenai, the governor of the region beyond the river, Shethnar Bozni, we are going to finish this. I got like 4 minutes. Their companions diligently did according to what King Darius had sent. So the elders of the Jews built, and they prospered through the prophesying of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the son of Iddo. And they built and finished it according to the commandment of the God of Israel and according to the command of Cyrus, Darius, Artaxerxes, king of Persia. Now the temple was finished on the third day of the month of Adar. All right. The third day of the month of Adar, which is the sixth year of the reign of King Darius. And you guys all know what day that was, right? No, I'm kidding. You know, I had to look it up too, because I'm just like, I'm not familiar with the Hebrew calendar. As many times as I've looked at it and seen it, still don't have it memorized yet, but I have trouble with our calendar, right? Moving along, yeah. Okay, so, you know, the preaching's going on. Everything picks up when they do it. On September 21st, and this is, you know, this is by a lot of different scholars' estimates, September 21st, 520 BC, right? It was finished on March 12th, 515 BC, nearly 4.5 years later. That was 72 years after, approximately 72 years after the destruction of the temple in 587. It, you know, so it's like the 70 years of captivity that was promised by Jeremiah and Zechariah. you know, that's what we have, right? It was 70 years. So God keeps his promise, and he does this, okay? All right. So the children of Israel, the priests and the Levites, and the rest of the descendants of captivity celebrated the dedication of the house of God with joy, and they offered sacrifices at the dedication of the house of God, 100 bulls, 200 rams, 400 lambs, and as a sin offering for all of Israel, 12 male goats, according to the number of the tribes of Israel. They assigned the priests to their divisions and the Levites to their divisions and the service of the God in Jerusalem, as is written in the book of Moses. And then, lo and behold, what happens? The descendants of the captivity kept the Passover on the 14th day of the first month. Right? So you have the altar, you have the temple, you have you approaching God, making yourself that sacrifice. You have the place where you go to worship him, and then you're reminded of the Passover. Who's the Passover lamb? Jesus, right? So Jesus is our Passover, you know? And it's like here, verse 16 tells us, the children of Israel, the priests, the Levites, the rest of the descendants of the captivity. So they have come from captivity from Babylon. And remember, this is a small percentage of all the tribes that have come, right? I think it's like, can't remember, what do we say, like 85% was still back in Babylon, right? So a small percentage has come, but yet, you know, all these sacrifices are given, and it's paid for by the pagans, right? It's like, hey, we need 12 bulls. Okay. Right? Anybody else want to get polled? I don't think so, you know? And the descendants of the captivity kept the Passover on the 14th day of the first month. Jesus is your Passover lamb. Jesus is, you know, everything we see here, God just plays over and over and over again. The priests and the Levites had purified themselves. All of them were ritually clean. They slaughtered the Passover lambs for all the descendants of the captivity, for their brethren, the priests, and for themselves. And the children of Israel who had returned from the captivity ate together with all who had separated themselves from the filth of the nations of the land in order to seek the Lord God of Israel. That's one of the things we do when we come and we prepare. What is one of the things they would do to their homes to prepare for the partaking of the Passover lamb? Exactly. Everybody got that, right? They got all the leaven out of their house. Most of you know that. You understand that. And we know that generally leaven, though it's not all the time, but leaven often means, you know, sin, right? It's representative of sin. And here, you know, the sin has been gotten out. It's been taken out. And you and I, we can't make ourselves sinless, can anybody else? Anybody achieve that? Have any of you achieved sinlessness besides you, Michael? Michael's even, no. Don't lie about it, you know. I won't put that on you, brother. But you guys get that, right? None of us has made ourselves sinless or done any of these things. Yet, you know, Jesus Christ and what he has achieved on the cross and what he has done in his sacrifice for us and the infilling of the Holy Spirit has made us, he has put his righteousness upon us. He has put these things upon us. And it says, not only did they partake of the Passover, they kept the feast of unleavened bread 7 days with joy. For the Lord made them joyful, turned the heart of the king of Assyria towards them to strengthen their hands in the work of the house of God and the God of Israel. And we got through it. That was the chapter 6. So, huh? That was 6. We're at 7 now. So, you know, they finished the altar. They presented themselves as living sacrifices. They worship, and then they partake of the Passover and then celebrate the Feast of Unleavened Bread with joy. Right? And we celebrate because we partake of Jesus, who is, he's not just the Passover lamb, he's also the bread of what? Man, that's awesome, man. You know, everything connects. Everything is good there. You know, and it's like you and I, when we read something like this, It's a testimony, and that's one of the things Paul would made it. And he was like, you know, you can look into the law, and you see the testimony of God there. You see the fact that they could not live it out. They could not live it out. And God had to do it. God had to do it. God restored. God did this, and he always kept his promises. And if he kept his promises with them, he'll keep his promise with you. And he said, if you call him Lord, and you believe in your heart that he was raised from the dead, and you have believed, and remember we talked about that, that believe is not just an intellectual assent, but it's entrusting in Jesus. It's saying, I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that you rose from the dead. I know you did, and I'm depending on it. You know, it means something. It's like when you're getting married and you say, I do. That's a big deal, right? It's a big deal. And it's the same thing when we come to Jesus. We become the bride of Christ, you know. And here, God has made it where you and I can partake of that eternal Lamb and that eternal gift that he has given us of eternal life. I mean, it's just amazing. I think God is so good. Anyway, let's pray. Father, we come before you. We thank you, Lord, for this night. We praise you, Lord, that you, as you have brought Israel from captivity to captivity to captivity. And Lord, we were captive to our sins. We were captive, Lord, to our flesh, this world, the devil, as your word says, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, Lord. And sometimes we still find ourselves struggling with those things, but help us to remember, if we make ourselves a living sacrifice, if we seek to make ourselves holy, not that we work for righteousness' sake, but so that we might be acceptable to you. I want to do that, Lord, to move in that and to be that for you. Help me to submit to you so, Lord, I can resist the devil. I can't resist the devil if I'm not walking as you call me to walk. So, Lord, help me to do these things. Help me to be this, Lord, and help me to walk in righteousness towards you. Help each and every one of us to walk in righteousness towards you. We thank you, Father, that you have done these things in us, that you have led us from the captivity, that you've kept your promise then and now and in the future. Lord, we look for your quick return, but we also pray for those that we love and that we know that don't know you yet, Lord. We say Maranatha, but we also, Lord, want our families, our siblings, our moms, our dads, our everybody, we want them to be saved and to come to a knowledge of their Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we lift all that up to you. We praise you and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, God bless you guys. Have a great day.